What's up, everybody? This is your girl, Atalia, and today we are here at the Witstein Stadium where the Josie Book Fair is taking place. And Painables is here to find out what happens at a book fair. So let's go in and find out. You don't have a chance. I'm here with Karina from Wits University Press. Hi, Karina.
Hi, Atalia.
How are you?
I'm very fine. Thank you.
Can you tell us what you do at the Wits University Press?
Yeah, I'm responsible for the marketing. We are a scholarly press. We're based here at Wits University, and we publish scholarly books, academic books on various subjects, on philosophy, on rock art, on sorts of things. Climate change. We've got a book coming out on climate change.
And is it only international books or also South African?
They're South African and international. We have authors from all over the world, so we're not publishers of just of its people. No. So that's the mistake people often make. They think we're publishing just of its people, and no, we publish anyone from around the world who can give us a manuscript which then gets peer reviewed, and we decide if this is the subject that we want to publish. So we have certain subject areas that we focus on. Humanities, we publish art books. And social sciences a lot. We have an annual book called the New South Africa Review. And I should actually show you this. Shall I pick up one?
Sure.
So this is the new one. You can see it's interpreting something of, so it's an annual. Mm-hmm. It looks at aspects of the country, the economy, labor, education. This one, I like the cover we did this year. It's saying something about the movement, left movement of politics at the moment. You see the mic,
yes.
And this one says the subtitle is Youth Marathon. What has happened to politics and political movements after Marathon? Things have definitely shifted and moved. So
as a sociology student, I should have this book.
For sure.
Definitely. So, what goes on at a book fair? What is the purpose of a book fair?
A book fair is to make people aware of various different publishers. We had various events here with our books. So the idea is to make people more aware of books and to get them involved and to create public forums where publics can come and participate and speak to us. For us, it's also, of course, about selling books here at our company. And as I say, our events.
So is it an annual event?
This one is an annual. There are actually a few book fairs. There's the South African Book Fair, which is end of July, which has got a different kind of book. This one here is now for the first time here at Wits. This one, it tries to be more, I think, tries to involve inner city schools, working class people, workers.
So it's for everyone?
For sure.
And I love reading. I love books. But you know, there's this new age technology we have. How would you encourage people to buy books instead of downloading them?
Look, we publish a lot of illustrated books too, which I think is just packed away. So it's much nicer to have a book like here's one on Gandhi and Gandhi's Joburg. You know, a book like this, I think, is very nice to have to page. I mean, a coffee table book and a digital file on a computer. So I must say, we do have some books which I guess you could call coffee table books. But I find, what we find is that students want books that they can write in order. But, you know, I do also think that times are changing and that one changes.
So where can we find your books?
The physical books you can buy at Wits Art Museum, at Wits University Press's offices, which is in the balcony there, upstairs from the Wits Art Museum. Which is also open to the public. We have a whole spread of all our books there. Here was just a selection. And of course online, we've got a website, witspress.co.za. And there are other, like Take A Lot, which used to be Kalahari, online selling posters with them. And people can order books from bookshops.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Welcome, Natalia. Thank you very much.
With me here is Greg Minchuma, a 12-year-old who came here by himself at a book fair. Wow, that's so brave of you. Tell me, why did you come here?
I come here because this place is a place where I can have freedom and I can understand other children. Mm. And I can learn how to read.
And you can learn how to read?
Yes.
Did you do that here?
Yes. Here I've got some books. This one is a CD I got from Benamsoke. And this one is a book I got from the Nanibar.
So you love reading?
Yes, I do.
Daddy, your hair like a forest of African dreams creates a halo around your immaculate face. Deep, bold eyes seductive, straddling your tender nose. Then your lips carve the sea for kisses at dawn when night and day finish their love making under a crepuscular moon, swinging on moonbeams of rapturous pleasure. Your beauty is a myth, intangible yet tactile. You said regally, come. As a breeze, preparing to sleep without ripples, then your knees, then the legs, carved by a master sculptor, the day they discovered beauty, touch me.
Oh.
I'm just a Pitika Duli, an African poet and a sculptor, living a simple life in the context of my time.
And I just listened to an intervention we just had here, and you're talking about identity. Can you tell us more about that?
You see, when we are born with an identity, either a boy or a girl, or you are gay, or you are lesbian. You get in there, you are somebody else's child. Suddenly, you are somebody else's boyfriend. Then you are a student. And in all of these kind of categories, they define a particular role that you play in South Africa. But the ultimate role for us, as black people, is to be an African. And to be an African is not just about defining yourself, it's about defining the parameters and the boundaries around which everybody has got to understand. And you cannot be an African without being embedded in African thought, in African thinking, in African feeling, and in African thought. It is that African personality that Neruma Khumula was talking about, that is an ultimate identity that we have to. We say there's globalization. What is globalizing? Who is globalizing? And we know these Americans, they exist. The sad is about Africa globalizing. And yet we as African people have been globalizing in the first globalization. This is the 10th globalization process.
So as the youth, are we losing our African identity?
What's that? You've lost it long ago.
We've lost it long ago.
Yeah,
how
but,
can we
regain? Yeah, but I'm teasing. Normally when you look at you guys here, we say, hey, I sit in conferences, they say, there is a lost generation. The question I ask, whose children are those? These are our children. How did we lose that generation? No one asks. I hear more poetry being written by people your age. I hear songs sung in our languages, you know, by people in your age, while people on my age are still as precise in their English language as the queen herself dared to speak when she wakes up in the morning. So in other words, you can't get rid of it. You've got that residual African sense actually in you. I spend more time with younger people. I feel more African with younger people than with older people. That's a tragedy. Because we are compromised.
So what is your message to the youth?
Frantz Fanon, one of the African diaspora, he said, each generation must, out of relative obscurity, discover its mission, fulfill it, or betray it. The generation of the 1920s in South Africa here moved to the Soviet Union, led by Alfred Nzula. They championed the Black Republic thesis. The generation of the 1930s, led by the Kumetes And you know, but the Kumetas and the Moses Kotanes, you know, took communism to the third world. The generation of the 40s, led by Anton Mzwakhe Lembete, the father of the Youth League, brought culture and economy into the agenda. The generation of the 50s, led by Nelson Mandela, came with the defiance campaign to define the unjust laws. The generation of the 1960s, led by the redoubtable Robert Mangaliso Sobukwe, conquered the fear of prison and asserted an African personality. The generation of the 1976 conquered the fear of death and championed the issue of language. The question of the 1980s, the youth invented the toy toy to bring the country ungovernable. The one of the 1990s began on the economic transformation, but your generation that is coming in here is yet to discover its mission. Yo.
When then did the brutality of imperialist appetite and aggression evolve into something of such ominous value to us that we torture, mutilate, butcher in ways hideous beyond the imagination? Rape.
With me here is Azania and Ritabile, very intellectual, beautiful ladies who are here at the book fair. Can you please tell us more about your experience here?
Wow, okay. Mind-blowing, for one. I didn't know what to expect when I came here. I just knew we were coming to a book fair. And the closing of it was amazing because we were with Ntate Piti Kanturi, Mrs. Ndambusi, Ntate Mbedi, and Ntate Jason. And it was just an amazing conversation.
Mm-hmm. So, what have you learned from
you
or from the book fair?
No, the book fair. When I got here, I didn't know what to expect, but I was surprised by the amount of publishing here. Like, there are a lot of South African authors that we don't know about, and I wish could come out. Like, I wish people could celebrate them more than other authors. I didn't know we had such a variety of authors, and I'm very happy to see that, because I would really love pushing.
Pushing people to come to book fairs so they can promote African writers. Youngsters. So right here, it's a wrap from us, Pineapple.